welcome
you all to the July 7th meeting of the Board of Regional Commissioners, and we'll begin with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You should put America the Beautiful on your phone.
Nice.
Yeah, it would, yeah, especially at this appropriate time.
I'm sorry, you have a pen.
You know, I don't either.
Good.
I thought we did, I think they're in my briefcase.
Let's start with the summary of actions, because Sheila has another appointment.
Yes.
Yeah, we should be quick today, actually.
So we had a chance to go through the items.
There's a question, I don't know, one item.
There's 14 items.
There's actually 25.
Yeah, they just added some.
They missed number that day.
They missed number.
Oh, I see.
Oh, yes.
No, there are 14 that we have on the page, but one item has several pieces to it.
On item, there is an, I'm going to find it again. There was an item that authorized Kevin Galligan to sign out of state.
That's number 15.
Which 15?
Bottom of the page.
Yes. No, that's a request, that's different.
Oh.
This was one where we were authorizing him to sign, prove. We were authorizing him to do the approval. I don't see it on here. It wasn't the one I got in the mail.
I wonder if it was typed on.
Okay.
This is the old one I had. I don't see that on here.
Okay, because I have a question about that, about that. Well, since I don't see that on here, then I would move these.
Okay.
I second.
All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None opposed? Three in favor, motion carries. So, you have a report, Mark?
I do. I actually have a couple of things before I get to my actual report. I have to put in for your signature a cooking company, two copies of cooking company contract. As you know, cooking company, if you pass that down, does our third-party administration for our workers' comp claims. And you also are aware that as of July 1st, we moved our workers' compensation program to the fully insured Maya program. Pat, you'd be happy to know that.
Yes,
and so now we're really fully insured, so Maya, as of July 1st, will be doing all of our claims run out and all of the administration for that.
Case management, too?
They do everything.
Everything.
From soup to nuts. Okay. So basically all you have to do is notify them that there has been an incident, there's some forms you have to fill out, and they take care of all the rest. But, as you know, that only is effective July 1st. Everything that existed before that, there's not much. Has to be, you have to take care of the run out of claims, as they call it.
Right.
That's what this cooking company contract is for. It's for this year. We'll see if we need a similar service to extend into next year.
So the cooking company contract will run through June 30th of 2011?
Yes.
Oh, okay. And that's for the run out?
That's for the run out of claims, yeah. So that's there. I also have for you...
Just one other question. So all new claims as of July 1 will be handled completely by Maya and not by Cook.
And not by Cook.
Cook will just follow up with the current claims prior to July 1st.
Exactly. Okay. There's only one indemnity claim, which is, of course, the salary piece. There's probably a number of medical pieces that still have to be run out. So
That's just...
And the next piece I have is to give you the year-end 2010 salary reserve and fringe benefit transfers. As you know, any salary reserve transfers or account cleanup transfers and fringe benefit transfers, I go through all the accounts at the end of the year. I put together all the transfers to clean up all the accounts. I have done that for salary and fringe benefits. I need your approval to take care of those transfers, and that
I'll
will
move this.
Yeah, it doesn't need to vote, it just needs for you to approve it. Pat, and I believe all of you got in your mail, hopefully, and I have some extra copies here if you need it, a letter, a memo from Beth Albert, talking about the FY11 budget process and the human service grants. As you know, the Human Service Advisory Committee wants to come before you, and we've scheduled them for August 25th to talk about this. I think they're also going to be meeting with the Assembly at some point in time in the future. There seems to be a bit of an issue with the process that unfolded late in the budget process over at the Assembly, so they want to talk to you guys about that. So you should have that letter in your package. If you don't, I have some extra copies. And let's see. Also, I handed out for you, you should have...
Okay, just ask a question about this. In the second to the last paragraph, they say... they voted to request a meeting with the commissioners and the standing committee with the Assembly. So would that be a joint meeting with them or just with us and then with them?
I believe it's a separate meeting.
Separate meetings.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
It was as though I looked into a crystal ball.
Oh, the day the request was made?
So we'll meet with them and see what they have to say. And also, in front of you somewhere is a piece of paper that looks like this, and it's kind of your upcoming scheduled agenda item, so we know where we're going. So we compile with the open meeting law.
Right.
And just FYI, next week we will convene, and I'll need a start time, we'll do that before we end. And we'll convene here, but then we'll take a walk up and take a little tour of the new Health and Environment Department office tour. That's in the old jail space, so we'll do that.
When will that be, I'm sorry?
That's next week, Wednesday, the 14th.
Good.
We just have to come up with a start time. And then on July 21st, Lou is going to be bringing the British visitors in from Barnes, I assume they're from Barnstable.
Barnstable.
Yes, Barnstable.
Barnstable. And then on July 28th, Paul will be here to do the remainder of the CCC Cape Cod Commission update, the SEDS and the local technical assistance grants. So. And we still have to schedule, Bill. We're still working on the dental discount program announcement. We had a bit of an issue with our logo. It wasn't quite up to the quality that we were looking for to get on the poster and the card, so we're working on that. And we're also working at that on that piece of it. I've asked Beth and B.L. Hathaway to work on a comparative chart that shows what the actual costs retail for certain dental services are in this region. We had some nationwide data, but we didn't have anything that was a little closer to home because I think the costs on the Cape probably a little bit higher than the nationwide average for some of these dental services. So I asked them to focus on putting in the kind of local costs associated with that so it'll reflect the true nature of what people will get in terms of a discount with this card. So they're working
That's
on
good
that.
To know.
So once we have those pieces in place, we'll be able to...
And do you have any estimate as to when that will be done?
I would hope, but certainly before the end of the month.
Okay.
And then we also have to schedule the Cape and Vineyard Electric Co-op PV solar sites tour. We'll probably do that in September. A little bit cooler. So that's your upcoming schedule. Anything you want to add to that, just please let me know. And I have some good news from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. We did get our 2010 court rental audit results back. And I must say that we had a clean audit. In fact, they increased the reimbursement amount for administrative costs by $9,904.50.
What's a percentage?
So I don't, overall percentage, well, that's greater than 100% because we asked for 100%.
No. I mean, did they go up by like 0.5%, 3%, something like that?
Well, they don't do it by that. They do it by what you spent. That's okay. Every light bulb basically is accounted for in here. We asked for $1,687,294.90, and they are paying us $1,697,199.40. So they actually increased, and that was for the administrative piece of things. And basically, if you kind of understand the way this happens, is they had some money in that particular line item and had to get rid of it. So we were the beneficial recipients, and we'll take it. That's good news.
Very good news.
And so then that leads me to my final report. I did want to just let you, as periodically I've been giving you updates on what's happening with pension reform and with the municipal relief package. So I have this to give out. It's just a summary of what was in, take one and pass one down, in the outside sections of the Commonwealth's fiscal year 2011 budget. There were several of the pension reform pieces dealt with. There were basically two major pieces, I think, that they dealt with. First one was the health insurance chargeback. You remember I mentioned this before. Basically, what this would provide is that it portions out health insurance, a retiree's health insurance premiums based on their credible service in other units. That is to say, if I worked for the city of Boston for half of my public career, and I worked for the County of Barnstable for half of my public career, and retired from Barnstable County, basically you guys could charge back half of the health insurance premium to my prior service, the location of my prior service, wherever that might be.
That's effective July 1 of
this year? It applies to members who retire after January 1st, 2011. So it's not necessarily just for new hires, but it only applies to those who retire after January 1st upcoming.
So that's going to be
a mess.
I mean, a lot of administrative work.
It's going to be,
figuring out who, and then you have to make sure that the other community pays on time.
Yeah, they did, dealt with it. I think there's a lot of implementation issues to deal with, let's put it that way. They did straighten out one thing. They said that the law says that the other prior service units are billed at the lower of the contribution rates. For example, we have a 75% contribution rate. If I worked somewhere previously where they had a 90% contribution rate, the 75% rate would pertain, exactly. So it would be that proportion of the rate that was assessed to the previous unit.
So whatever the lowest of the rates that
is the one that prevails.
Is the one that prevails.
Right. Now, if the one I didn't retire from was lower than where I'm retiring from, don't ask me how to sort that out, because I couldn't at this point in time. I'm not sure how that would work. But I think it would mean you could only assess 50% of the 50% of the whatever proportion to the previous service place. But I think that's one of the details that has to be worked out. Basically, the way it will be implemented is notification of other units that they will owe you money has to take place on or before January 15th of the following year. And then it says other units to, quote, immediately take all necessary steps to ensure prompt payment, unquote. And I quotation mark that because I'm not sure right now how we're going to budget for such a thing, because I don't know what's out there from former Barnstable County employees who left here and retired somewhere else. And I wouldn't even know where to begin to start that calculation.
Well, you know, it's interesting. If you were the community that had the lowest contribution rate, you would end up, it's not the community, it's just the rate that you get.
Yeah, I believe
you could have been in a community that was 50%. And then retired from a community that was 80%. And maybe you had 20 years in the 80% and 10 years in the 50%.
Exactly, right.
But it's the 50% that would apply to your retirement from your 80% community.
I think the intent is
that's
not to change. I think the intent is not to change your contribution rate. So, for example, it doesn't change the retiree's overall contribution rate. If they retire from Barnstable County, their contribution rate from the county's perspective is 75-25. That doesn't change. I think what it does change is the county then can't assess 75% of its premium piece to a previous unit. It only has a 50% reimbursement rate. So there's going to have to be some prorating of the prorating, so to speak. I think that's what the intent is. I think the intent is not to try to change
To lower the
final
rate.
Contribution rate. So that was one of the big pension reform pieces in the outside sections of the budget. The second one was the pension cap. Remember, there were some there was talk about and proposals that were filed to basically limit the definition of regular compensation to a certain percentage of the federal limit, which is in the USC 401A17. This applies to employees who become members after January 1st, 2011. So this one does apply to new hires, so to speak, after January 1st, 2011. And they up the percentage, so it's capped at 64% of the federal limit. And I believe the federal limit for 2010 is around 240,000. Don't quote me on that, but it's close to that number. And 64% of that would be $153,600. So when you get to the point in time where your calculation is done on your three highest years, if you were over that amount, if you were over the $240,000 amount, they could only use, as of now, the limit of $153,600, and that's what they would use in terms of the average three highest
years. I guess I need a little explanation. Is that $240,000?
Is this going to impact you? It means to say, Bill, then, and don't forget, the federal limit adjusts every year. It adjusts. There's either at the CPI or up to $5,000. I think it has to be in $5,000 increments.
What does CPI mean?
Consumer price index.
Okay. Is the $240,000 an accumulation over 3 years?
No, that's a one-year limit. So in any one of those three years that you're calculating your pension, say it was 2010. So just for the sake of argument, say it was 240. Next year, say it's 245, and the year after that would be 250. And you take 64% of each of those numbers, and those would be your three highest year calculations.
That would be the presumption is that you would actually work for the Commonwealth and make $240,000 a year.
And well, there are some who do that.
If you're the president of a college.
President of UMass Medical. There's a number of places.
Okay, all right. So it applies to a very narrow segment of the people who become eligible for.
Certainly, yeah. It's a very narrow segment.
So as a practical matter, the great majority of population that work in state service do not enjoy it.
Actually, all of the ones who are current members of the retirement system and current employees are not impacted by this, because it doesn't apply until you become a new member after January 1st, 2001.
Okay. Right. That was the part I was trying to make clear to myself. Thank you.
That was the second biggest piece of the pension reform thing in the outside sections of the budget. There's a couple of others that I'll just mention. They did increase the so-called widow or widower's allowance. If your spouse is on a disability and they die, there is a provision in the law for the widow or widower to get a retirement allowance. And they increased that from $6,000 annually to $9,000 annually. They changed.
Is that dependent upon a community accepting that local option about whether or not to include spouses in the retirement system?
No, don't forget that's for health insurance benefits. This is for retirement benefits. And this particular provision is not a local option.
Oh, that's okay.
They changed the interest rate for contribution returns. Right now, if you have less than 120 months of credible service, under the new law, you'll get 3%. And if you have anything other than that, you'll get, and don't ask me what this means, it's not clear to me, 100% of the rate of regular interest payable. And that's in quotes. And I don't know what that means.
Okay, 120 months as a practical matter is vesting, or like you have need 10 years for vesting, right?
Yeah, basically it's less than... If you're not vested, you'll get 3% back on terms of all your accumulated deductions.
In a lump sum. Okay, but if you're vested.
If you want to take your money out, which some people do, you would get, quote, 100% of the rate of regular interest payable, unquote.
They determine.
It could mean, does that mean our 8.25% actuarial interest? Does it mean the standard rate that a bank would pay. I don't know.
The cap of 1%.
I think that will have to come out in the regulations that go to fix this. One of the other provisions, it provided the state and teachers' retirement systems, the retirees with 3% COLA. And as you know, our local system took that loan already to provide that 3% COLA. It fixed the so-called clothing allowance issue, and what that was is there was a court judgment that basically said clothing allowance is not regular compensation. Unfortunately, didn't clarify whether they meant that prospectively or retrospectively, and retrospectively it would have caused a big mess for a number of people who are already retired and already have their calculations made, already receiving benefits. Basically, what this did was it grandfathered all of those people in. It provides for a, quote, full evidentiary hearing, unquote, at DALA. That really was inserted in there to, I think, straighten out some of the process changes that maybe have been happening at CRAB, which is the Contributory Retirement Appeals Board, and at DALA, which is the Division of Administrative Law Appeals. And finally, it provided for a reform for the Essex Regional Retirement System, which had some issues of control, and PARAC was in charge of it for a while. So that's what pension reform did. Now, that's a lot smaller than some of the reforms that were out there and the proposals that were out there. And I think next up, I've included that in here too, is really the municipal relief package, which has two kind of major pieces, which is the pension funding schedule extension, that's in there, and it has the early retirement option that a lot of people have been talking about. So, but I don't see a whole lot of other pension reform pieces happening anytime soon. I'm sure they'll come back in January of 2011, but I think that's pretty much it right now for the pension reform piece. So.
And the early retirement is not like the previous early retirement package. It requires that people give up, if they want to retire early, they have to give up their vacation or their sick leave.
Yeah, there's a couple of provisions. And this is all, I believe these were in the, it's in conference committee now. There are two versions of municipal relief, so we'll have to see what emerges. But the previous versions were only 3 years, and previous ones back in 2002 and 3 were 5 years. It was only 3 years. You had to give up any accrued vacation or sick time that you would have received payments for as part of your retirement. You had to give those up. And it required the unit to do basically a cost analysis of how much they would save. You had to submit that to PARAC, and it had to get approved by PARAC. So, it was not as simple a process as in previous early retirement options. So that's it.
Do we have any other votes that we have to make besides what was in the needs action?
No, that's all that I have.
What did Maggie bring in?
She did have something, I believe, she said.
About that needed to be signed?
I think she said she had some votes, if I remember her saying, right?
I think that's what she added, didn't she?
What did we vote on?
Yeah, she did use the word votes.
She did, and you know something, Pat? They're in there with blue tags on.
In here?
Yeah, I believe they are. They looked like we already voted on them. I mean, you'll see that a blue sticky. We have a person here who's a friend.
Yes, a friend of yours?
A friend of mine, but also a friend of the county in a way. Bill, you probably knew Bill Wendell. Mm-hmm. This is Mrs. Wendell.
Mrs. Wendell, how are you?
Nice to see you again, Bill.
Yeah. It's nice to see you. You just here visiting, or would you like to make some comments?
Do you have anything to say about the county and how we can?
No, it's air conditioned. They came in here
to cool off.
So it's a wonderful place to be.
Bill, as I think we both know, and my son both graduated from Dartmouth College.
Great. And your grandson is there? Or?
No, I think my grandson has to figure out if he can qualify and whether or not my son can pay for it.
Oh, yeah.
But that's another thing. No, my son graduated from Dartmouth.
Ah.
That's a very good story.
So how are you?
Good to see you. It's nice to see you too.
Oh, I guess maybe I should just ask, should we continue the discussion about the big Cape delegation meeting?
Yes.
That's a good idea.
That will be for the NSTAR. They would like to know where we are on that committee. I am going to invite, I did speak to Matt Patrick about that probably 6 weeks ago, so a month ago. And I think Sarah Peake would like to be part of that delegation as well. I mean, part of the committee, just to keep abreast of it, and that is fine with me. I did speak to Senator O'Leary about it. He's very interested in knowing, I don't know if he can attend, but he wants to be abreast of what can be done. And this committee, subcommittee, if all agree to be on it, is really to hopefully, there's all different entities out there all concerned about the same issue, looking for some action and about herbicide spraying on the Cape. The county has taken action to the point where we can. We were able to put a moratorium on the herbicide spraying until all the wellheads are identified. And I think Paul spoke to that a couple weeks ago. 14 of the 15 towns, or 13 of the 15 towns have asked for that service. That is just beginning, and which is a perfect time now that we have just a little under a year to form a committee and look at options, because if there is to be any alternatives offered, that has to be approved by the state. What everyone is using on the Cape, including our other economies out there like farming and landscaping, etc., they are all using what is approved, the three herbicides approved by the state. And if those aren't acceptable, then I think this committee, if they could work together and identify acceptable alternatives and have the state seriously review them. I am going to ask someone from the Agriculture Department to...
Agriculture Department?
I mean, the Department of Agriculture.
The state. The federal.
State.
What about a cooperative extension?
State. And absolutely, Bill will be, yes. He's definitely...
Because I think he should learn a lot of information with regard to...
I think he has a tremendous amount.
Fertilizers and pesticides.
And that may help. You know, that would set a compass for the group if he was able to bring that to the table first. And this is what it is. This is where we are. This is what's out there, and let them go from there. Because a lot of people, it's a lot of times you have to understand that there's unintended consequences for saying, let's just do this. And I think that if they all work together and we can help facilitate that, then they could maybe accomplish what they want.
And we've looked at this item before, especially when we've been monitoring the purity of wells that we've dug. Mm-hmm. The issue is always in following the manufacturer's recommended dosage with regard to these items, and that the problem comes that people, instead of following the directions that they're given, decide that the more you use, the more effective it is. So the outcome of that is the more fertilizer is used than necessary, which leads to algae blooms, and
right.
more pesticide is used, which leads to an infusion of, of concentration of toxicity that isn't necessarily matched to what the state recommendations with regard to application. Each one of these pesticides has a very clear statement outlined in something called an MSDS, which is a material disclosure statement. And all of these have in it the amount that is supposed to be used with regard to the area that it's, you know, that it's spread on. Now, I don't know, because I hadn't been overseeing what happened with NSTAR, but I suspect that given the cost of this material, that it was not They did not use an excessive amount.
Well, they spray using a backpack. I mean, a guy goes out with a backpack, so they look for a specific plants or flora or whatever it is to spray. So it isn't like they go out and spray a whole area. They're very diligent about how they spray and where they spray, and they don't just spray everything. Mm-hmm. They only spray species that they feel are, or that they know based on their criteria, are inhibiting the...
What they're really trying to do, I mean, you know, NSTAR is able to be targeted because they are a corporation, and, you know, everybody was, you know, they were an entity that you could point to and say, you're like big brother, bad guy. If you really look at what they're trying to do, yes, there is this cutting first, and then this several years of spray. There was a heavy spraying, and then this targeted spraying for several years to discourage the large growth and let the natural growth come in, so that their plan is in 5 years, 6 years, when all this undergrowth comes in, they don't have to spray really at all. They can just go and prune wherever they need. They can't let citizens do that pruning because now there's a federal law against it, because there was a big blackout, because someone said they were going to do such a thing, they didn't do it, a tree branch broke a line, and, you know, the Northeast went into darkness. So they cannot do that. Or that was what happened here on the Cape. It was within the last 6 or 7 years. I'm sure Sean could even tell you that. Sean O'Brien, but
I'm just trying to remember what exactly.
When the blackout.
That was during the wintertime.
But the idea is to be data driven.
Yeah.
You know,
what we don't know
right now is where, you know, relative to these spraying areas are our critical water wells.
Right. Well, that's what we're.
Then once you know that, then you need to know. Well, then what's in those? You know, test the water in those.
Right.
Well, the meeting with them is really to just kind of talk about the issue and sort of lay out a roadmap.
Right. Right.
Of where we think we need to go and what are the resources we need to get there,
right.
And what's the best way to do it and who should be involved. And that's kind of it at this point, I would think.
Yes, and hopefully it will be an education series, and a lot of education will come out, not just for businesses across the Cape, but for individuals, because probably individuals are the biggest culprit, especially, you know, when you don't know what else to do with your stuff and the dump is closed and you want to get it out of there.
So we will tentatively shoot for here, either 11-12 or the commissioner's office, at 11 o'clock
on 12th,
Monday the 12th.
Which
we'll
is this coming Monday.
Right. Yeah. And that's just for the reps and ourselves and anybody else in the public who wants to.
Yeah, we have to post it.
Right.
Are you guys available later in the day? Because sometimes they like early and late and not in between. You know how they, you know how the delegation can be.
I am.
Wait a minute. I have the MPO meeting at noon. And then
I have to go, unfortunately.
The votes we were supposed to make that you were going to add.
We're talking about the 12th.
Well, we put the, where they probably need to.
I can make it later in the afternoon.
You can.
I can.
And the vote asked to take.
Yeah.
Is there something else to sign right here?
Just to give me notes. Just to have an alternative. All right.
So this is July 12th.
Monday.
Do we sign this? Or do we just vote on this?
Yeah, because we meet anyway at 9:30, so.
We three. Yeah,
either 11 would work really well.
Yeah, that's fine for me. 11 is fine.
11 is really great. Otherwise, if we do it later, then I have to twiddle my thumbs all up somewhere. Not.
We'll see.
I have to be excused.
Okay, we're almost done.
No, I did. You're not here Friday, but if I have questions, I'll talk to you tomorrow.
That's just an initial.
Call me on cell phone.
I will. Thank you.
So I will send you guys an email and confirm that when I know.
Okay.
Thank you. Good to see you.
Yeah,
I hope your cold is better, Bill.
Thank you.
I can hear you have one. And
I have one more question for you. You know, on Thursday, July 22nd at 9 a.m., it's the AmeriCorps graduation.
Yes.
You know what else happens to be at Thursday night?
Fire chief.
Yeah. The read I get is that sometimes the July meeting's not very well attended. Maybe it would be better if we do AmeriCorps and push the fire chiefs off, but it's up to you, it's your call.
There's one in August?
I believe so. We have one every month.
Why don't you just, who's the person that you...
Well, I just ask Lee, but I can talk to the chief whose name escapes me right now.
Okay. Yeah, talk to the chief. Fill that out and see how that goes.
Okay.
And then we, you and I can talk about that. I'll see you on Monday. So
yeah,
we can follow up on that.
Yeah.
Then. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you all.
Yep.
Good to see you. Thanks.
So are you, we adjourned or?
Recess.
Recess
to
the
assembly.
Although I don't intend to go over there.
I don't intend
that
either. Oh, I should say.
Suppose I don't go.
They will ask you.
Yes.
How much money do we have?
Yes.
You tell them you don't know. You have no idea.
Books are closed.
Just say that, say that we...
The books are closed after the 15th, right?
They'll be closed as of this Friday, basically. Because I gave you the transfers for the salary and fringe benefits, the warrant for the payroll was posted, but the warrant for the accounts payable hasn't been posted yet. It'll be posted tomorrow.
I did have...
I can give you the numbers from June, which were very strong.
Okay, I'll take the numbers from June.
The number from June was up 97.8% from the same period last year.
Wow. 97.8?
Double.
From last year?
Well, everybody in June, of course, was rushing to
get their... Well, June 30th was supposed to be the last day,
right?
Right.
They were rushing to get their tax credit.
Right, and July will be...
So,
July will be the same, no, because they extended it. Well, July,
that's right,
August,
extended it 3 months.
3 months. July, August, and September will be the same, or similar.
So the bottom line is...
You can't judge anything by that.
Yeah, it just, that's good news. So that will,
so what's
it bodes better.
What numbers am I looking at?
Just so
I
look at June.
Just June.
See the 818 versus last year 413. That's the best number to look at.
That's not something I brought in. The only thing that, this is what I brought in. The occasional carryover people piece.
Are you going to be saying anything?
Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to be there, and I'm not able to do it. And Beth has been...
As long as you didn't have a vote. I thought you said you had
votes. I did. I had permits. I wrote them out. I wrote the votes out.
Today?
Carry over the vacation,
yes,
carry over designated.
And she's giving a full report on that.
And I asked them to initial it.
Is,
and there is Robin's personnel paper changing her title and needs your signature on it. I'll get you that from you. Other than that, everything. It was just simple stuff, like changing. I wanted to get all their titles changed for.
But... Beth has it all prepared, and she is really, he's the person that helps coordinate,
and
but the plan,
I'll be back in my office.
The execution, all of that, you know, came from the co-chairs. Bob Murray can't be there today either, and I asked if she wanted to cancel it for another time, but she felt very prepared, but, you know,
okay.
I just wanted to make, I wanted to be there just to make sure
I'll be
everything
there.
Went appropriately and according to procedure and process. Well, we'll see, but
okay.
Thanks.
Yeah. Let me ask you, this is the number for this year, for this year.
Yeah, total.
And what was the number for last year?
I
see. That's it. 09.
Oh, yeah.
And
exactly.
This is 010.
Yeah.
And that's 09, and this is 2010.
Yeah.
Wow.
For business and for the, it's one of them is the deeds, one's the business, one's both.
Yeah. Okay. We received a letter from Sandwich now, asking us to fund the a scientific review of the MEP model from SMAS, and we've already written the letter. So now we have them from Yarmouth.
Orleans originated.
Orleans.
Yarmouth.
Yarmouth.
East Ham. And Bourne.
Bourne. And now Sandwich. That's five.
Was there any contribution mentioned in any of these letters to support the cost of the study?
No. They talk about grant funding or whatever.
Yeah, I think Brian House, Dr. House, is coming to the Comprehensive Wastewater Review Committee in Falmouth. I think it's going to be their meeting the first week in August. I can't remember the date.
It might be good to put Brian and Andy on an agenda of the Selectmen and Counselors Association.
That's a very good idea. Because these letters, well, they're coming from the selectmen now, aren't they?
They come from selectmen, yeah. This is selectmen-driven, I believe.
Okay. That's a good idea. Well, they're not going to meet again until the fall.
Well, I know, but...
But that's still a good idea.
Yeah, this isn't, like, month time sensitive, no.
Right. Okay, so, and then we have the letter from Andy, which was very good. Mm-hmm. And then Andy has another letter that went out, sort of...
You got to P.M. Lombardo.
Regarding the P.M. Lombardo.
Yeah, letter. I have that, too, if you need copies of that.
The Falmouth just appointed someone to the Wastewater Collaborative, not me. It was too complicated for me. I wouldn't be comfortable being both roles, to be honest with you. I mean, it's just, it may be, there may be nothing really illegal about it, but the appearance just doesn't work right. But what I would like to do is attend the meetings.
Bob Troy did say that. He said there's no conflict.
There's no conflict.
You have no personal financial interest.
In anything.
If you feel that way, you know, we did appoint Sheila to be on it. Should we rethink our position there?
Well, it's July. Don't we look at our appointments in July anyway?
No.
In June?
We look at them in January.
That's right. Well,
since Sheila's not here, you probably wouldn't want to talk about that when she's here. You know.
So you may not know your feeling on that.
True. Well, yes. Well, I'll make a point of asking her next week when we meet. But I think, who knows when the collaborative meets? Is it the first? They only meet once every three months, don't they? It's a steering committee.
They were certainly meeting more often than that, but
they are.
I haven't followed them more recently, so I don't know.
I know there's a meeting next week, I think, on the 14th.
I believe there is. I thought I saw a posting for that.
You did? I'll go check.
Yeah, I would ask Kara to have her send you the schedule for the... Let me do that.
Okay. You may want to attend just to get some...
I want to attend just to get...
Yeah.
To get the feel of what's happening.
Board. Hmm? You have a new composition on the board.
The collaborative board. Right. And I think it's good to, because it's such an important issue, it's good to stay on top of it. Mm-hmm. Right, that's all I had on my list of things. So unless there's any other business, we can have a motion to recess.
Just a reminder of the graduation on Thursday, July 22nd.
Okay. Meeting is in recess.
I'm sorry. Start time next week.
Oh, yes.
10 o'clock?
Still on. 10 o'clock.
10 o'clock. Is that all right with everybody? There's no assembly next week. We will convene here and then go up the hill and do a little tour.
July 14th.
July 14th.
At 10 o'clock? That works. Here, right?
All right.
So, oh, that's right. We're taking the tour up the hill.
Yeah. So I'll say, like, the tour will start at 10:15 or so. But we'll convene in 11 and 12 or your offices.
Okay, so we're meeting at 10.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. All right, that's it. Thank you all very much.
Now we're recessed. Good.
See you.